Welcome to tonight's performance in Jackson Hall. We are recording this performance for the University Archive, and so we ask that you keep distractions to a minimum. And that means, of course, silencing your cell phones. Please also take a brief moment to note the exit nearest to you so that you may use it in case of an emergency. Enjoy.
This is always really exciting for me because I really like to talk, and so I made sure that I brought a piece of paper so that I wouldn't stray away from what I'm supposed to say. So, hello, welcome to this evening of music. My name is Josh Garcia, and I'm the director of the California Aggie Marching Band. Go Aggs! In front of you right now is the UC Davis Campus Band, and it is made up of students from all aspects of UC Davis, which is awesome. In case you didn't know, it is Women's History Month, which is a fantastic time to celebrate women. And so, all of our music this evening is featuring women composers, which is a big deal because up till this point, the music industry has been really dominated by male composers, and I think it's important that we give a little bit of notice to this and feature these strong, intelligent, powerful women. So everything you'll hear on this concert is very different, and so there's gonna be some things that you're like, what is that? Why are they doing that? And that's okay, but they're really chancing, taking chances and making some great musical choices. This next piece is called City Rain, and it features our very own Sydney Bonnell.
Thank you.
So that piece was supposed to represent Rain in the City, which, had I told you that, you might not have seen it. If you would have closed your eyes, I promise that you would have, all right? This next piece is something that I really want you to close your eyes and think about, okay? And you don't have to do it now. You don't have to close your eyes and then... I mean, unless you want to. If you want to close your eyes, do your thing. However, I want you to think about something. I want you to think about a woman in your life who's made a positive impact, all right? Think about that person. I always think about my mom. She's lovely. And now, I want you to move forward, even if it's just for the next day. Do things with a purpose. Do things for that woman in your life. All right? And that's exactly what we're going to do. Our next piece is called One Life Beautiful. Thank you. Hey, that was real pretty, wasn't it? So this next piece is completely different than everything else that we've played, and I made that promise at the beginning. So, before we do that, however, I want to just say some thank yous. Thank you to Phil Daly, Pete Nolan for giving me this opportunity, as well as the stage crew, because they can set up a stage like really, really fast. It's really impressive. And then most importantly, the students, because without them, this entire thing is impossible. So thank you, students.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm Pete Nowlin, the director of the concert band, and welcome. We're so glad to see you this evening. Before we perform pictures at an exhibition, I'd like to do a couple things. One is to say a few words about the genesis of pictures at an exhibition and how it came to be. The second is we'd like to kind of track you through the piece and play a few key moments for you. And then I would like to familiarize you with the hieroglyphics you'll find on the back of your program, which are an exhibit map that I have created for a previous performance of pictures at an exhibition, and that I think can really help you keep track of where you are and what you're hearing as we perform this great and popular masterwork. So, Pictures at an Exhibition is inspired by Mussorgsky's attendance at an exhibition in memory of his very, very good friend, Victor Hartmann, who you see at the top right, Mussorgsky at the top left. Hartmann died very young and very suddenly of an aneurysm, and it was very difficult for Mussorgsky. It's quite likely slash generally accepted that Mussorgsky probably had deep feelings for Hartmann. Mussorgsky's homosexuality complicated other emotional challenges that he had, and a very huge fight that he had with the bottle all of his life, and resulted in his also passing at a very young age. Now, it took quite a few hands to bring us pictures at an exhibition so that we would know it and love it at this time in history. Some of them are pictured there. First of all, we see in the top left Vladimir Stasov, who was a Russian art patron and critic, and he built a group of literary artists, visual artists, and performing artists who wanted to inject Russian things back into Russian art. It had been, as was true in America in the 19th century, quite a European affair. And so with the lead of this group of composers who came to be known as the Mighty Five or the Mighty Handful, some of which are household names still today, Mussorgsky was at the forefront of injecting Russianism into classical arts in Russia. Now, Rimsky-Korsakov has a special place in the history of pictures at an exhibition because when Mussorgsky died, he left his music not in a great state and not all highly organized. And Rimsky-Korsakov assembled quite a lot of them, some of the operas, and amongst them, Pictures at an Exhibition. Now, one of the things that we find about Pictures at an Exhibition that is each one of Mussorgsky's friends slash arrangers gets a hold of it, they decide that they need to fix a few things. So Rimsky-Korsakov started right out fixing a few things that he thought he knew better than his friend. Now, in the 20s, Maurice Ravel set the very famous version that we know for orchestra at the urging of Koussevitzky, who also later did a version of his own. Tonight's version is a fantastic version for wind band by John Boyd, the former band director at Indiana State University. At its heart, though, Pictures at an Exhibition is really about Mussorgsky and Victor Hartmann. I mentioned Hartmann died very young and of an aneurysm. He passed 8 years before Mussorgsky passed, and it was very difficult for Mussorgsky and pushed his life in a not wonderful direction. We can see some of the effects of life on Mussorgsky. We see here a dapper 20-something, and then just 20 years later, when he was about 40 years old, one of his very good friends did this portrait. Now, I will emphasize, that was done by one of his friends. In fact, this is considered a great example of portraiture by his friend Ilya Repin. It's really thought to capture him. This was done right at the end of Mussorgsky's life. He was living in a military hospital, and Repin scheduled 5 sittings for this portrait, and he got 4 of them. When he returned for the 5th, he learned that Mussorgsky had passed in the intervening 2 weeks. Repin sold this painting. It was very, very highly in demand, and donated the funds to a memorial, to build a memorial for Mussorgsky. Now let's get to Pictures itself. Pictures is framed by six movements called promenades. These, Mussorgsky says, are... The composer here portrays himself walking, now right, now left, now urged to go near a picture. At times his joyous appearance is dampened as he thinks in sadness of his dead friend. So, we see here a theme which, maybe like Mussorgsky himself, is not quite proportional. You can see that in the middle, we have these two repeated figures. Now, we could have easily had symmetry on the sides of those, but instead we have three notes before and four notes after. Now, you'll notice that of the four notes on the right, if I point it out, maybe you'll notice at least that the three notes are the same as the first three notes. So why does a composer change the order of those notes? Well, at the beginning of the phrase, he needs something that sounds like it's opening, and at the end, he needs something that sounds like it's closing. So we get bum, bum, bum. Sounds like it's opening. Bum, bum, bum. At the end, we get bum, bum, bum would be the three notes. Bum, bum, bum. By adding that fourth note, he greatly adds the feeling of closure to this later passage. Bum, 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 bum. Some of you will know that that's because he adds the dominant. Now, even if you don't read music, I think that the graphic nature of these can help you to remember the themes better as you encounter them as we perform them. Now, this first promenade, Mussorgsky striding into the exhibit, leads to the first movement known as Nomus, the gnome. And of this, Stasov wrote a drawing of a little gnome on deformed legs. Now, it might be this drawing. We can't say that we know, but it's possible. We will now hear the end of the first promenade, Mussorgsky striding into the exhibit, and the very first notes of Nomus as he is taken aback at the seeing the gnome. There is that theme that you just heard of the note, the first bar. Dee-da-da-dee-dee-da-da. So Mussorgsky, taken back by the gnome, we now hear the entire movement of the gnome. And when we get to the end of that, Mussorgsky moves on and we hear a second promenade, but it's different. Perhaps encountering his friend's art has made him remember him more profoundly and brought feelings of grief. It's soft, low, and mellow. Now that promenade leads us to a movement called The Old Castle. Stasov says of this, a medieval castle before which a troubadour sings. In this movement, you'll first hear the bassoon playing that theme that you see with the repeated notes at the top, and then the flugelhorn will enter playing what is probably the troubadour's song. Now, when the bassoon plays, I always feel like I can hear the moss growing on the castle. You know, bassoon is always used to portray old things, like Grandpa in Peter and the Wolf. So bassoon, old. This is the old castle. Now, we're not gonna hear any of that. It will lead us to another promenade of renewed vigor, which will then lead to a movement known as the Tuileries. Now, we don't have any idea what this painting actually was. So I have just thrown in a little Manet to inspire us, a painting of the Tuileries. Stasov says, an avenue in the garden with a swarm of children and nurses. Mussorgsky gives it the subtitle, Children Argue After a Game. I think you can hear the universal children's taunt of nya na nya nya in this, the Tuileries. The Tuileries. We then move to a movement called Biedlo, the ox cart. This is inspired by a trip that Stasov took to Poland. Hartmann took to Poland. Hartmann was a Polish Jew and was inspired by he was concerned and politically inspired by the bad things that happened in Poland. And he did this drawing, which is a painting of a Pole being executed for political activities. This may be the drawing that is contemplated in this, or it may just have been some other drawing of an ox pulling a cart. In Biedlo, the ox cart, you will hear the low woodwinds playing this repeated eighth note that is probably representing the wheels of the cart turning. Bing, bong, bing, bum. While the brass, horns and trombones, play the main theme. The ox cart. After another promenade, but a promenade with a very different feeling, we get to this promenade. I will go, it's a bit more disjointed feeling because we lose the first two notes. You'll notice we have our two little statements and our last four notes, but at the beginning, there's two notes missing. And that gives it a very unsettled feeling. This leads to the ballet of the chicks in their shells. Let me find my. Stasov says, Hartmann's design for the decor of a picturesque scene in the ballet Trilby. You can hear the chicks in their shells, I think, there, right? This leads us to, I think, the heart movement of the piece. Two Jewish men, one rich and one poor. And I say that because these are two paintings that Mussorgsky owned, one portraying a wealthy patrician Jewish man and one a poor street beggar. They each have their own theme. Ba-dum. Ba-dee-um, da-da-da-dee, da-dum, a regal theme for the patrician, and da-da-da-da-da-ya, kind of a relentless theme for the beggar. The most interesting moment of this movement for me is when Mussorgsky puts these two themes at exactly the same time, a conversation between these two men. The two men, one rich, one poor. This leads us to a movement called Limoges, the marketplace, which may focus on this sketch. This is a page of sketches from Hartmann's trip to Paris. And they believe that this may focus on this group of women and that he sets them in the marketplace at Limoges as they discuss and argue about the great news of the day. Now, the last note that we heard, I think you hear the bustle of the marketplace in what we just heard, but the last note was actually the first movement, first note of the next movement, Catacombs. Whoop, it didn't go. This is actually a self-portrait of Hartman. He is one of the two gentlemen in the top hat, and it shows him in one of the catacombs in Paris from his trip to Paris. And we see over here a group of glowing skulls. And Mussorgsky said of this movement, "The creative spirit of the departed Hartman leads me to the skulls, calls out to them, and they begin to glow." Catacombs is these sorts of long, loud brass notes alternated with softer echoing sounds. It leads to another promenade that has the title Con Mortuus in Lingua Mortua, with the dead in a dead language. And it is a very, very different feel to the promenade theme. It is asymmetrical. It's actually more symmetrical than it has been at other times, but feels more haunting. You can see here that our da-dee-dum is now da-dee-dum, and that all of the groups are three notes. Let's hear a little bit of that. That is put against a tremolo in the upper woodwinds and stuff. It's a very haunting and haunted music for Con Mortuus in Mortua Lingua. There's those skulls. This leads to the penultimate movement, Baba Yaga, the witch of Russian folklore who lives in the hut on foul legs. Stasov says, Hartman's drawing depicted a clock in the form of Baba Yaga's hut on fowl's legs. Mussorgsky added the witch in flight. So this, here's our chicken legs right here, right there, the front of the hut. And here are a couple other depictions of Baba Yaga from more recent. This is a 1902 painting, and we see her hut in the background as she menaces. Baba Yaga rode the hut through the woods, eating the bones of children. So we hear in this movement her stomping through the woods. We hear her flying. We hear her sometimes sneaking up. Over here, we see the hut on fowl's legs from a more recent version. Let's hear a little bit of Baba Yaga. And now let's see what we just heard. There it is. Angular stomping. We get then to the final movement, known as the Great Gate of Kiev, which is based on this drawing, which Hartman submitted in a competition to design a new gate for the city of Kiev, a gate that was never built. No gate was ever built. But this drawing inspired Tchaikovsky to write this noble music. Great and noble gate indeed. So now, if we can bring up the lights a slight bit and we'll look at our map of the pictures exhibition. And you can also look up here. Now, this was actually designed to be the opposite sides of a flip, so I have to guide you a little bit. But here we go. We start out we have Mussorgsky entering to the robust promenade, encountering the gnome, played by these low instruments. Then that more thoughtful promenade, played by these mellow instruments, leads us to the old castle. So if you see a red arrow, it means there is a breath between the movements. On the back, we'll get to some that have a green arrow, and that means they run right together, like the catacombs movement did. We get to the old castle, then we have another robust promenade that leads us to the Tuileries with the nyanya, nyanya. That brings us down to the ox cart with the theme by the brass, and then that more thoughtful promenade brings us to the ballet of the chicks in their shells. Now, the challenge you have is at this point, you have to jump to the very bottom because you would be flipping the page in the other way this is used, and you see a red arrow at the bottom and the number 10. That's where your map continues. And you come into the two men, one rich, one poor, and their dialogue. Then a robust promenade leads us to Limoges, the marketplace, the women talking and the bustling marketplace, which runs directly, see, green arrow, runs directly into catacomb. We're in the catacombs of Paris. Then we get this mysterious statement, con mortuus in mortua lingua, which leads us to Baba Yaga, the hut on Fowl's Legs, which runs directly, green arrow, into the Great Gate of Kiev, bringing you to the exit from the exhibition. Please enjoy tonight's performance, and thank you again for joining us of Pictures at an Exhibition.
Thank you. Thank you.